So good evening again. We are B2CK, Cédric Rier and Nicolas Evra, and we are going to talk about testing your code with Python. We are both B2CK shareholders, Python developers since 2001 and Triton developers since the very beginning of Triton, so 10 years. And Triton is an ERP written in Python using PostgreSQL as a backend and
with a GTK client and a web client written in JavaScript and so on. A lot of code because here is the timeline of the number of line of code we have since the beginning, and now we are around 400,000 lines of code. So with this amount of code, it starts to become difficult, or it starts to be a problem when you make a change in such large base code to be sure that you don't break anything inside the whole application. And so that's why testing is important. So why we are writing tests. The first is to be sure that the code we are writing now behaves like we expect to behave. So
it's important indeed. Then we want to ensure the correctness of the code, but not only today, but also tomorrow and in 10 days and in 10 years. Because we make change in one place and we want it to work anyway in 10 years with all the change that we have done.
So that's why testing just now your code yourself manually, it's a problem because you don't want to repeat yourself tomorrow to make the same test again and again and again. So it's good to write test for that, which will be automated. Another point is once you have found a bug in your code, you don't want to have to get the same bug again. So the best way is to write a test that's unsure that this bug doesn't reappear again later. So you add a test when you fix a bug, usually.
And the last point is that when you such a base code evolves, it's like that. You cannot be right on the first time on everything. On something you can, but on everything it's impossible. Thus, you will have to rewrite sometimes large part of your code, and to have the confidence that you don't forget anything, you have the test to help you change that. For example, when we switched from Python 2 to Python 3, testing helped us to ensure that the automated tools that we used didn't break anything. There were bugs, of course, but...
Yeah. And it also, what gives you the test is to be sure it gives you the confidence to change your code. You are no more afraid of changing or of improving some part because you know, thanks to your test, that you are not breaking anything but just making the code better by refactoring or changing something. How to write test. Indeed, there is different kind of test for when you develop. We have the unit test, the integration test, the functional, the tests that are generated, and you can also test the performance of your application. So just...
This is an outline of the test that we will talk about. By the way, if you want to interrupt us, please do so. We will not bite you.
There is some good practice when you are writing tests. The first one is to write tests that are isolated. The second is that your tests are reproducible or written in a way that it's deterministic, so you don't the result doesn't change depending of the external condition. It's good to make it fast. It's better to write simple tests because you don't want to also debug your own test because you make bugs in your test. So it's better to make it simple. And automating the testing is also good because otherwise you forget to do it and you start accumulating the issues.
Yes. What do you mean by isolating test code?
Indeed,
it's the next slide.
By isolating, we mean that when you run one of your tests, it doesn't depend on, for example, having other tests running before or other tests running after. So you should be able to just run this test alone. And it doesn't change the state after the test. The software is back at the same state as before the test. Like that, you can run any test in any order, and they don't interfere with each other, and so you don't have side effects. Mm-hmm. And the good points when if you write your test like that. It's that you can run your test in parallel, and so make it faster.
Okay, so I don't have much to do to say.
Yeah.
So why should test be reproducible? Reproducible. Okay, it's to avoid the common case that we have all seen once, at least once in a lifetime. It's the case where your customer or your teacher, or I don't know who, tells you, it's broken, but it's not broken on your computer. So it's to avoid this syndrome of it works on my computer and I don't have to fix anything. And so a way to do that is to use static inputs for your test. So obviously, random values, using random values could be a nice idea that you might have. I test with anything, but no, in fact, it's a bad idea. Another
or at least, if you need to use random. Your test should give you, if they failed, which random value it used. Like that, you can reproduce with the same state.
Yes. Then there's also an issue with date and times, because sometimes you run the test in a... for example, we had this issue a few weeks ago. I don't remember. We were usually running the test during the office time, and for whatever reason, I was working. It was 11 o'clock in the night, and our test started failing. And I didn't understood why, because obviously I didn't change this part of the code. And the reason was that the tests were running in the time zone of, I'll say Japan, but it's not Japan, but I don't remember the name of the time zone. And this is because we didn't set the time in the test, and it was already another day in Japan and not in Belgium, so we had an issue.
And for that, there is libraries that help you to avoid this kind of issue. For example, there is FreezeGun. So it's a Python library that you can use to decorate your test, and it will fix the date or the time during the run of your test. So it changes the standard methods that give you time and replace it by a fixed time. So you can you are sure that your test is always running at a specific time, the time.
And you should also beware because sometimes randomness is hidden. For example, we had some build recently that failed because of the Python hash seed variable, which is...
I can maybe explain.
Yes.
I found it. Indeed, it was a test, a part of the code, which was at some point relying on the order of the keys of a dictionary in Python. And the order of the keys depend of how the hash method in Python is hashing the keys. And Python use a seed at the starting of the runtime, which is random, which make the hashing method not
stable.
Yeah, or it's different for each run. So it's a protection against some kind of attacks. Mm-hmm. And then in some case, the test was running with a seed that makes the keys order a little bit different, and the code was failing. So yeah, but thanks to the tools we are using, we know the seed that was running for this specific run of the test. And so we could reproduce it and understood what's happening. So yeah, at some point we can refine the bug and make the code no more depend on the order of the keys. So yeah, next.
So your test should be fast because for one simple reason, you don't want developers not to run the test. If it takes 5 minutes to run the test, they will launch the test, then either they will work or they will wait for the test. 5 minutes is quite a long time, so they will go on Reddit and they will spend an awful amount of time on Reddit and have no information that the test has failed. So you want the test to be fast because it helps in development. No, but even if they don't go to Reddit.
It also helps you if you are able to run just a part of the test. So often you are working on a specific method or a subset or some object. And so you want to be just able to run the test just for this part when you are developing it. Like that, it's faster. You get the feedback quicker. And of course, at the end, when you think you are ready to commit, you run the test for everything. Because maybe you have broke something else without knowing.
And so in order to be fast, common things to not do is to make extremely large computations or to use slow network connections or connecting to a database and so on. So yeah, it allows you to be a bit faster.
There is also the setup. Sometimes the setup of your application before running your test would be slow, so it's better to improve it and make it faster. We can maybe explain what we do for with the backup of database. Yes. Yeah. For Triton, for some part of the test, we want to use the full stack with the database and so on to be sure that it's working. And instead of creating the full database each time at the beginning of the test, what we do is we create once the database. And after that, we make a copy, a dump of the database, and we restore the dump for each other test. So we get a fresh database, but that is loaded very fast because there is a dump. And when you are developing, you run with an initial database dump. And so it's very fast to just load the database, run the test, and drop the database, and so on. So
yeah, it can reduce the time 30 times or something like that. I don't remember the...
I think for some tests, we went for 1 minute to...
Yes.
Yeah. 2 or 3 seconds?
Yes, indeed. This morning I had to recreate a database. It took 1 minute, and running the test afterwards was 2 or 3 seconds, so it's a big win.
And for Triton, the particularity is that the database is created out of the classes, so it's a big machinery for that. That's why it's a lot. Yeah, the test should be simple, as I said. So for that, you should be careful to test your code and not your dependencies, because you should consider that your dependency is already tested somewhere else in their code. So focus on your own code only. But of course, don't fall into writing too trivial tests that are too obvious, because the test will not catch the issue. So you should, for that, you should test the behavior of your code and not the implementation. At some point, you should write your test without really looking at your code, but just.
Yeah, just thinking at what this function does exactly and what do I want this function to do, and not, okay, I will. For example, the classical example is the factorial function. You can write it in many different ways, but in the end, we all know what we want to test is that factorial is the definition of the mathematical factorial. It's a bit a stupid example, but.
And each of your tests should be focused on testing one thing in such way that when this test is failing, you know exactly where is the bug. Normally, you should not need to debug yourself the running of the test or to replicate it manually. You should know exactly where is the bug, because the test should be focused on one specific test or behavior. That you know where in the code this could happen.
And also making the test simple will make them easier to maintain, because okay, even if you are only testing the behavior, sometimes your API will change and so on, and you will have to change a bit your test and adapt to those changes.
The test should not become a blocker for you to make evolve your code. You should be able to make evolve both, and it should not be a pain to make your test evolving.
Yes.
Otherwise, it's counterproductive. Yeah.
And so the test should be automated. And why should they be automated? So for this, we use continuous integration tools. In fact, we are using Drone, but in Python, you have BuildBot and you have the Jenkins also. It's not Python, but. And so it allows you to run the test on every commit. So you are sure that every commit is really tested. People should do it themselves, but you are never sure that they do it themselves. But if you have a tool that do it for you, it's extra.
And also, like that, you know which commit, which change break your test. So yeah. you will have a hint about who was the guilty.
Yeah, and why did it break? And also, having a continuous integration tool will allow you to test on multiple environments, because developers usually test only on their computer, of course. And it allows them to, okay, I will test this. I will think, of course, about different databases and so on. But I know that it will be tested anyway on a multiple matrix of environment. So, for example, we can test on PostgreSQL, SQLite in different version of Python, even Python 2.7, and so on. And of course, when it breaks, it allows you to send an email to the people that have pushed this this commit, and it allows it push them to be responsible of their code and fix them.
And don't expect someone else.
Yes, to do it for them.
Yeah, so the tools that are available in Python for testing, we just names few of them, but the big one. The first is to write your test case. The standard library comes with already few tools. You get the unit test, which it's easy way to write test.
Yeah, it's a part of the Java library.
Okay.
Somehow.
You have also the doc test modules, which is another way of writing test. And you have now the mock library, which allows you to mock up some objects and so on. But we will have a word about the mock later.
Later, yes.
After that, when you have your test case, of course you need to run. So you need to have a runner for that. By default, unit test is a runner. And on the recent version of Python, it can discover the test automatically. But there are other tools like PyTest, Nose, and Docs. Maybe you can talk about those.
About Docs?
Or
yeah, not that much, in fact. I think that PyTest is probably one of the most popular runners. Indeed, it's quite nice because there is less boilerplate code compared to unit tests, but in the end, we didn't use PyTest and we stick to unit test because it works quite well for usage, and the extra feature of PyTest we add in fact too much complexity, so we don't use it. We use only unit test.
Yeah, and we use Tox because Tox is a tool that allows you to run your test in different Python environments, and it automatically set up everything for you. So it's very nice tool to use if you are writing software for that should work on for different Python version.
Then there is behavior-driven development. This is where you you define your the behavior of your application with usually and the way your application reacts. So there's usually three keywords. One where you say, given I have this function and this data, when I do this, I expect to have this result, which in theory allows people that are not used to write tests and to write code to write a lot of tests because they are functional people, they are marketing guys or I don't know what, and they should be able to write those recipes. But we never really tried it because in the end, you have to make a lot of pattern matching to define a lot of stuff. And we were never really convinced by this approach. So,
yeah, because you have to transform the sentence into a real test code. And at the end, it's probably faster to just write the code than having something. And you have also some tools that generate tests for you, like hypothesis. So you define the set of your inputs, which kind of inputs your method is expecting, and which kind of outputs it should give. And the tools will generate random value inside this subset to and test the output for you. So it's kind of automatically generated test.
And Hypothesis is a bit clever because it tries critical values like known, zero, small numbers, empty strings.
So we'll see a little bit later. So
it's a small.
Recapitulate what we see initially. So we have different kind of testing, and now we are looking at each one. So the unit test. What is unit test? Is about testing the smallest part of your code. So usually just the function in Python. So you are going to test only this one function in one test. And usually the test is about putting some output, fix it output, and testing that the giving some input that the output will be what you expect. So you are just testing your function as if it was a black box, and just testing that you have the right output depending of the input. And of course, you should be a little bit clever about which kind of input you are going to test.
Yeah, you know your program, so you know the critical cases somehow.
So the good practice to write unit test. There is a pattern which is named AAA. It's a way of arranging your code in such way that it's easy to understand the test. So the first part is you arrange your code, the setup of.
Yes, you prepare everything for your test. So if you have to define some objects initial input.
Yeah. After that, you just act. You make only one act. So it's just maybe calling the method. And after that, you test the result. So you assert.
That's the output and is exactly what you expect, and you might have multiple asserts because you might
No, normally you should have only one assert for each test because you are testing only one thing per test. If you start to have multiple asserts, the problem is that you will the first assert will fail, but you will not know the result of the other assertion. So you should try to write only one assert and maybe testing in your assert multiple things at once, but that's the pattern. After that, for unit testing, as we said that you should test only one function, sometimes your function depends on other function or on some object that are interacting with the other part of the software, and you want to avoid that. So that's where the mocking of objects happens, or you will need, maybe.
Yep.
But with our experience.
Yes.
we think that you should try to avoid to use any mock. It's complicated to maintain because each time if you change your the internal of your methods or all the objects you are mocking change a little bit, you have to rewrite your test and ensure that it still behaves correctly.
It's having your code perfect the first time is very difficult because you will refactor a lot, and so you will add to the refactoring of your application also a refactoring of a big part of your test if you have mock objects everywhere. So it kind of blocks you when you want to. If you have too much mock, it will block you in some in some way, because you will have to, of course, if the world was perfect, if you were perfect, using mock would be ideal, but it's not the case.
Yeah, and also we say that you should test the behavior of your methods and not the implementation. And in some way, using a mock is starting to test your implementation, and not the behavior.
Yes.
Also, another point, which is probably a little bit controversial, but we think that you should try to avoid to design your API to allow dependency injection. It's a common way of isolate your methods to be sure that you run only, you have a small part of code that you can test easily. It's by injecting the dependency. I don't know if everybody knows what is dependency injection. Yeah, no. If your methods needs, for example, a module, to call a module, let's say datetime, the datetime module in Python, to get the date, instead of importing datetime directly and using it in your methods, you have an attribute of your not an attribute, an argument of your methods, which contain the datetime modules that you can change when you are calling from your test with something else, for example, a Mockit object. And so you are not depending, when you run your test, it's not using the datetime module, but what you want. And so it's a way to be able to test without having the side effect of the datetime module. But the issue is that you change your API to allow easily to test, and maybe your new API it's not so good because maybe you have a lot of.
It's a bit artificial API because you make your API artificial just in this for the sake of testing, and so it's according to us it's always a bad sign.
Yeah. And your code can become a little bit like spaghetti because. If your method is calling another method, which need also to inject some dependency, which also use another method which has other dependency and so on, you start to have to inject a lot of dependency on one method because it's calling many yeah. others. And so at the end, you are designing an API too easily to test and not for really the application.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So some good practice somehow of this using unit tests in Python. You should use when you write your test function, test methods, explicit doc strings because the test runners will show you the doc strings. And so when it breaks, you just have to read the doc string and you will know exactly. If you have the name of the function, okay, it's a good reminder, but with the doc string, it's way easier. Also, you should use assert equal instead of using assert A equals B because it gives you more information. Because if assert equal fails, you will have both information about what is the value of A and what is the value of B, and you can make the comparison yourself.
There is many other tools in the unit test. For example, you have the assert raises, which allow you to test that an exception is correctly raised, because it's important also to test that your method is returning the right result, but also failing the way you expect it to fail. You have also the assert warns and logs. It's warns is when you put warnings in your code, so like that you are sure that the warnings are correctly displayed. And the logs is when it's to test that some logs are generated. You have also the assert equals, assert dix equal, and so on. You have multiple kind of assert depending of the type of object you are testing. It gives you a nice result when it's failing. The assert list equals show you the elements that are mismatching, that are in one side of the list and not the other, and so on.
And there's also at cleanup, which allows you to register functions to be run at teardown in the setup, because sometimes you define, you use some information in the setups that will be completely forgotten in when you make the teardown. So you need to somehow have this environment to restore them to the to their pristine value.
We use it, for example, to change the configuration values at the beginning of the test and restore the initial values. So we get in the setup the current value of the configuration. We keep it in the context of the callback that the add cleanup will add later. So we can restore the right value. There is another kind of test. Once you have testing your unit part, now you need to test that they behave or they interact together correctly, and that's the integration test. It's about testing that all your parts or all your units interact.
Il reste 10 minutes.
So that means, indeed, usually that you are not going to test some function inside your code, but more the public API of your application. Like that, you trigger the interaction between each component.
So some good practice. Of course, you should not forget to clean up after running the test, because as you are testing integration, you will left some cruft everywhere in the application, and so of course you have to clean up. And this kind of tests are more designed, in our understanding, to check the absence of error when all the parts are running together, rather than final result. If you have designed your application well, you know that each function is, because you have unit tests, are behaving like it should. So it's more ensuring that everything works together and works well together. So it's more testing that there is no error. Yeah, and in Python, the way to do it is somehow to have in Triton we notice integration tests, because we have setups method and teardown methods for those tests, because we have to set up a lot of stuff that will be used for every test, and of course to tear them down.
So the next type of test is the functional. Here, when you do functional test, you are going to test the behavior of the application from the point of view of the end user. So you, for example, in the case of writing an ERP, you are going to test with functional test the whole workflow of a sale. So you will create a sale in your application, which will create shipments, which will trigger the creation of invoice and of the payment. And so you have to test the whole workflow for just a simple case, a simple sale. But you are ensuring that everything is correctly interconnecting, and that the sale create correctly the invoice and so on, that everything is working as expected. And so to be able to make such a functional test and to be sure that it's really useful, you need to run it on the full stack of your application. This means that you need to use the database and not to mock your database. You need to use the network if it's connecting to other services. You need to test that the access rights are correctly applied, and so you are sure that the user will have access to all the documents and the workflow and stuff like that. And for that, the best way is to simulate the behavior of the user. For example, you can use tools like Selenium, which is a way to script your browser to click on buttons and so on, and you just trigger like if you were a user. Or another way is if you're, like it is in our case, your application is
yes, if the application is divided in multiple tier, you can just make RPC call, and that's what we do because we have a library that allows to make quite easily RPC call to the main server. So.
And so we get all the full stack. And usually, the way of writing functional tests is by using doctest. This is a kind of test we have in Triton. It's just making a sale order with some sale lines and some quantity. And at the end, we check that the amount are correctly and the workflow is, here we have the methods click that simulate a click on the right buttons and so on. And for you have also Selenium, which is about testing web application, and it's a library that allows you to manipulate, to drive a browser. And here you have the case for Firefox. And as we said, you have initially a setup and a teardown because you need to set up and prepare the application before running the test.
And just go back. We just test that there is no error, and also we test only a basic stuff so that there is no result. But we don't test the whole HTML that is generated. We test only a small part, the one that is interesting for us.
This is because you don't want to rewrite this test each time you make a little change somewhere in your template. Yes, another kind of test is the generated one. As we already a little bit explained, it's about testing the properties of the output using random input. But the random are not completely random. You define a scope inside which the system will pick values. And another kind of testing is to try to put any fuzzy input, so random data, and try to break your code with that. It's more about security.
Usually it's more about security, and we find that in C code, but in Python, of course, it's interesting also, but it's less. We never did it yet. Maybe we should try, but.
Usually, such genetic test, it's good to not include it in your continuous integration. Sometimes they are slow often because they generate a lot of cases and so on. But also, it's not reproducible. Like we said, it's important to be able to reproduce your test in case of failure. And here, the issue will be that for one commit, maybe your test will fail, but not because of the commit, but it's an existing bug in your application. And on this specific run, the generated tool will generate, will trigger this bug, but it just by chance. Mm-hmm. And so you don't, it's not a good idea to mix up the both and make things the developers has broken something when indeed it was already broken since a long time, maybe. So the generated test is good to just run from time to time, but outside the common development workflow.
Yep. And so this is an example of hypothesis. We never used hypothesis yet, but it's on our to-do list. And so you can see that you have there a definition of the input values for an hypothetic mean function, and you define that the mean function must the property that the mean function must follow. So if you were back into your first year of computer science, you might remember that you had to write comment on disait ça encore? Invariants for your loops. And this is somehow the invariant of your loop, somehow. So it's a bit interesting.
Yeah. And the last kind of test we are going to talk is about performance test. It's a test that you are going to run from time to time, like the generated, and try to measure the difference between versions, usually, to see if you are if your code is going faster or less faster. You should be careful when you make such measurement about the warm-up of your application. So if there is the warm-up of the application, the warm-up of the OS, the warm-up of
the database.
Yes, many stuff. So it's it's quite difficult to have correct result for that. Yeah. But anyway, sometimes it's useful to be able to compare and to increase the performance.
And it's also more one-shot stuff because you will have a customer that rings you, oh my god, this report is taking hours to run, and this is the time where you will do your test, but it's not something that you do often in the course of usual development. Of course, you should think about performance, but it's more abstract.
And also, you can test the load capacity of an application if it's a network application.
Yeah.
And you do that by firing a lot of requests to your application. So to measure time, there is timeit modules in Python. It's not the perfect tool for that, but it can give you some hint about the performance. And for performance, for example, there is the Boom library, which trigger a lot of requests to your website and make some measurement and tell you some average and so on. So, in conclusion, this is more about how we see the testing. We think that we should write enough tests to be confident with your base code, but you don't have to write too much tests so that they will block you and prevent you from evolving. So it's a balance you should find between all the kind of tests also, between the unit test, the integration, and the behavior test, in such way that you are confident that your application is working well and that you can make it evolve with with peace.
With peace of mind.
So,
any questions? Yes?
When you spoke about not building too much APIs with
Indeed, we see that in Triton we write more functional tests and integration tests than really unit tests. We write unit tests only for the core of the framework, but in this case, there is not too much need of dependency injection. We try to have to reduce the dependency, and but sometimes we mock.
Yeah, but.
Or we patch also. The mock modules allows you also to patch specific methods of other objects, so you can just
limit
the
scope of your mocks.
Yeah.
No questions? No remarks about the fact that we should do more testing. Okay, thank you. And.